feel love.
Do you feel His love this morning?
Yeah.
Thank you,
amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Call to worship that I wanted to read today. I think you may see a similar thing. Isaiah said in chapter 63, I will speak of the loving kindness of the Lord, the praises of the Lord, according to all the Lord has bestowed on us, and the great goodness toward the house of Israel, when He has bestowed on them according to His mercies, according to the multitude of His loving kindnesses. For He said, surely they are my people.
Yeah.
Aren't you glad that you may say, that's my God, but He also says, that's my people. That's my people. They are children who will not lie, so He became their Savior.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
Our Savior.
In all their affliction, He was afflicted.
Yeah.
The angel of His presence saved them in His love and in His pity. He redeemed them. Yeah. He bore them and carried them all the days of old.
Wow. Thank you.
We've got a God that loves us.
Yeah.
And He doesn't just say it flippantly or callously or meaninglessly. He says, I am here with you. I save you. I hold you. I carry you. I will minister to you. That's the love that we're talking about today. The love that's here for you and the love that's here for me. And I don't know what your week's been like, but I have a feeling, since I live in the same world you do, it's a lot of stuff that'll beat you up this week.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff that'll wear out the reserves that you had. It could be work, it could be family, it could be things beyond your control. But can I tell you, the love of God is the strength that you need. The knowledge that God is your Savior. We think that's just coming to an altar one day. My God needs to save me every day. Every day He needs to carry me and bear me. When God delivered Israel from Egypt, He didn't say, okay, you're out, make it on your own. So as the church, He says no different. Okay, the cross is done, you're on your own. No, I am here with you. I will carry you. I will do everything that I need to do to see you safely home. I don't know how close we are to home, but until I get there, Jesus is with me. I know we talk about Jesus is going to meet me at the gate. I understand that feeling, but no, Jesus is going to walk with me all the way there, because I don't know how to get there. He already does. So He loves you and He loves us today. Let's pray as we just worship Him in this house today. Father, thank You for the love that You have just thrown out to us. You've given it to us. Like that good seed that the sower sowed in the New Testament, so You brought Your love to us. God, even before we recognized it, even before we wanted it, even before we responded to it, You loved us. You didn't become our Savior after pondering it for a while. You became our Savior when You saw our need. And dear God, I want to thank You that I and these others that are here are testimonies to the saving power of Jesus Christ. And dear God, we are also testifiers of the loving kindness says of the Lord. It's not just one, it's not just two. In fact, dear God, I can't count them all. I can't use this time to just think about them all, because they're too many to recount in this short time. But God, let me just respond to the loving kindnesses by saying, God, I trust You in this service. I trust You with this hour of my life. I trust You with my heart. Don't let me close it, Lord, because others have hurt it. Don't let me guard it because others have manipulated. Oh God, let me throw the doors open wide of my heart and say, King of glory, come in again, fresh and new for this Sunday. And oh Father, I trust You with my life. So if You tell me something that I need to do in my life, I'm not going to put it up for a vote in my heart. I'm not going to evaluate it sometime in the future. I'll not put it on my to-do list to come. But dear God, today I will say, I surrender to Your truth, and I will live what You have shared to me in love, God. When I think about these dear people and all the needs that they carry and all the power that they need, I know, God, there's nothing in me that can help them. But I know the Holy Spirit today is bringing exactly what each person needs in this room so we can all leave this place satisfied in the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you grant that, Lord? And I believe, dear God, out of your good heart, knowing it so well, you will. But God, help us to trust, love, and worship in this time. And dear God, may all praises be to you alone.
In Christ's name.
Amen.
Praise God. In the Lord, gracious and goodness, good to us. Amen. I'm like the songwriter says, I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus. Amen. Let's sing it unto our Lord this morning.
Right here, like he is, right? Amen. Let's say, he loves me. He loves me.
is right for the redeemed. Is that not right? There are certainly wonderful things that the Lord has done throughout history and still doing in His church today. Having choirs, having praise teams, having singing groups, they're wonderful expressions of love and worship. But worship is not about hearing. Worship is about giving. Worship is about you giving something to the altar. If we'd put ourselves in the Old Testament, we can't say, well, there's five or six people bringing something up to the altar, so I'll just let them do mine for me. That didn't work. Bring your own offering, your own gift, your own worship before the Lord. And that's what He still expects. He still expects the fruit of our lips that praises His name. So while I love hearing good singers, I love hearing everybody sing around me, what's most important is that from these lips, I testify to the goodness of the Lord. And that's the power of yours too. I say, you need to praise the Lord. And what do I hear? I can't sing, preacher. Well, let me tell you, let me deal with you like God dealt with Moses. Who gave you your mouth? Who gave you that ability or so-called disability to sing? God knows how you sing. He didn't say, I'm letting you off. He said, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Amen. Nobody can praise for you, but I'm glad you're praising because that praise is beautiful to God and it enhances our worship. You know, other people can get a blessing off of you being blessed. So I say, God bless me, because if that person is not getting blessed, I want something to fall off of me and hit them. That's encouraging and lifting up one another. So I'm not here for what I can get. I'm here for what we can receive from the Lord. And another thing that we can receive is comfort and encouragement by the Lord doing work in the lives of people around us. That's what prayer is about. Prayer is not a laundry list of these are things on your agenda for you to do today, God. No. Lord, here's the needs I recognize. The needs coming out of my life, my understanding. God, I want you involved. I don't mind praying for the nations of the world. That is appropriate. But I ought to pray for needs that I know, names that I know, people that I see suffering. I ought to pray for them. And it's easier to pray for China, because I don't know what's going on in everyday life. I may hear months down the road, but I don't know right now. But that person down the street that I'm praying for, I can still look at them and watch them, and my faith is challenged, is it not?
Yeah.
God, they got cancer. Can I pray for that? My faith says, yes, I better be praying for that. Well, they've got serious issues going on. You've got to move. It's impossible. Where's our faith? Our faith says, yes. Yes, Lord, you can do the impossible with those things that are around me. So let's do pray for those needs that are around us. Two, I especially want to remember within the church, continue to remember Miss Rachel. She just gets lower every day. But, you know, that's our perspective. Devon Kelly is the same way. But they're getting closer to home. I understand from my perspective, and it saddens my heart, but I got to turn that thing around because the Bible says that we've been lifted up to heavenly places. So we don't look at the earth. This stuff is dying down here. But things, heaven's being populated every day with new people that have finished their course and done with their race. So life is breaking out all over. So they're closer to home. So pray for them in that process. It's a hard prayer because it's hard to pray for things, something you've never been through. But I do pray. I pray that God will lead them in ways that I cannot. But that God will also minister to the family. That one's an easier prayer because I've been there and so have you. So let's do pray for both those who are at that stage of life where they're in God's hands alone and also for the family that are supporting the blessings. Bless the name of the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. Can we end the prayer just by lifting up a hand and saying, thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for hearing us. Thank you that our prayers matter. Thank you that we are working with the sovereign God. Thank you that you've heard and will answer. Thank you, Lord Jesus, in your holy name. In your name.
Thank you, Holy Father. Thank you. Thank you. Praise His and Lord, of course, Jesus Messiah. We do that with the whole song, yes, of course.
We never read of them getting up. But we never hear about that because there's something for us in worship. And so taking the time to worship, it's not only what He desires of us, but it's what we need. It is put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. So if we're wanting to be fulfilled in this very service, understand what I'm saying today. Don't come in this church naked. Don't come in with nothing for Him. You put on the garment of praise, and somehow the spirit of heaviness is going to leave. Your downness is going to depart. Your attack. The devil's not staying around here. He doesn't want to be here. He wants to be where God is not honored, where God is forgotten. You fill this house with praise, the devil will find something else to do. I might meet you when you walk out the door. But this is a holy place. Not because the workers were holy that built it, but because God said, when my church is together, divinity steps in the room. God manifests Himself. We say that, but I challenge my heart today. Do we believe it? Do we believe it? Because when Jesus came to Israel, He never walked alone. When the new church, when they knew Jesus was in town, what did they do? When they knew He was even in the country, they left their jobs, they grabbed their family's hands, and they said, work can wait. They said, the bank can wait. They said, everything can wait. But I don't care where He is, wherever He is, I'm going. I'm going to be there. And it said once they got there, a few others showed up. But it said they didn't allow space. They started crowding in. And they started reaching. And they started grabbing. And they started like the deer on. She went underneath. They couldn't get above. She went underneath just to touch Him. Is that my heart? Because Jesus never said, go home. I'm tired of you. He said, come. All you who are weary and heavy laden, come. So you're crowded, but you're inviting more. That's because He's got more. He's got more. I'm reminded after He was so tired going across the sea, said, let's get away for a while. They met Him at the other shore. And I love the words of Scripture. He didn't act like I do. I'm tired. Leave me alone. He looked at the needs and He said, I see a bunch of sheep without a shepherd. So the shepherd stepped down and ministered to everyone. Why does Scripture include that, church? Why everyone? Because every need matters to God. You're putting your need under somebody else's today. Well, they've got it worse than I do. They may have. But you need God too. Don't leave yourself out. When the crowd is coming, why be on the outskirts? Why be like Zacchaeus? I hope he comes this way. But I don't know. I'll just look in the tree and see if I can see something. No, Jesus wants to come by. And Jesus has come by. So what do you need? I'm going to preach, but I want us to pray. Because I don't care about preaching, but I care about God having His way in you. Father, I can't pray for them, but I will pray as their pastor. God, if there are needs that need to be addressed, dear God, we can't go forward. I feel right now until we ask. Because the Bible says we have not because we're not asking. And we may have various reasons. Somebody else has got it worse. My need is too small. There's too much going on. Or I need to get out. I don't need to extend this too long. God, whatever those are, dear God, push them off the table. Dear God, let them be cast aside. Because the lover of our souls is here. I feel a stirring in my spirit. I feel your nearness, O Lord, but I feel you're not here just to give a little tingle. You're here to touch real needs and to minister to people who don't need to leave this place without having an encounter with God in this service. God, that's excuse, I'll get it next time. No. I don't know how you'll be next time. I don't know if there's going to be a next time, God. This is our opportunity, the only one we know we will ever have. So God, let the prayers rise to you even now that says, God, you know me better than even me. So God, meet the needs that I have. That's not selfish, that's obedient. Meet the burdens of my heart. That's not self-centered, that is submissive. So God, even as you're working now, continue. Father, if there's a burdened heart and that heart will not be left alone, let them take a step forward, because obviously you don't want to touch them there, you want to touch them here. Sometimes we need to gather together and intercede for one another. Sometimes God, we don't need to just be lone rangers. We need to let the body of Christ love on us and bless us and pray with us. So God, as you deal, let people respond. Hallelujah. Respond, Heavenly Father. See, my brother Tommy back there, you've got firefighters, they ought never go in the house, a burning house alone. They ought always to have somebody that's got their back. And if things go bad, they have somebody to pull them out. That's you, oh God, and that's your church. You are here for us, but we ought not do it alone. God, we ought to lean on one another. As the Bible says, we even ought to confess our sins one to another, that the Bible promise may be fulfilled, that we may be healed. God, I don't want to be dysfunctional. I don't want to be broken. I don't want to be less than. God, I want to be all of that you have for me, and I want the same for them. So let your spirit work, even now. Even now, my God, bless. Thank you, Jesus. I want us to hear again the word of the Lord from Isaiah. The other stuff I was going to say will leave for another time. Just hear the words again, because I believe they are important. And I always believe, I believe in God doing His work. I believe what a Pentecostal church means is not written in a manual in my office. I believe what the Pentecostal church means is we let the Holy Spirit do what He wants to do without interference by our own wills. So, I continue to let Him do what He wants to do, but I believe it's His Word that we stand on. I pray you receive what you need from the Lord, but my spirit is not satisfied yet. But this feeling, even if it's great right now, it will go away. And the doubts will come. And I can promise you the devil will come. And he will say the exact opposite of what you need to hear right now. He will oppose you. He is out for you. He's not overlooked you. I talk about often, our God does not miss us, and He does not. And neither does the devil. Because just like God has given us just a small amount of time, the devil knows he has just a small amount of time. Because the moment we pass from this over the veil, and the moment we pass from this life to the next, or the continuation of this life into eternity, he can't touch us. He can do no more for all eternity. And I just want to say, blessed be God for that truth that I know today. But today, he has opportunity. Tomorrow, he has opportunity. And I'm afraid he has people that speak for him, that probably work, live, and are involved in your life. But can I tell you the word of the Lord that always dispels and sends away the assaults of the enemy? It says, God says, Isaiah said to the people, they are my people, children who will not lie. Children who are, in other words, they're honest in this relationship. They won't deceive. They won't just say it with their faces. They'll say it with their hearts. He became their Savior. That's Old Testament. And it's in the part of Isaiah where they would need hope in the future. It wasn't a need for the day. It was a need to come. they would need a Savior, and it would come very soon. Not in Isaiah's day, but very soon they would be in captivity. There's no way to get home. Impossible to get home. God says, you're in exile because of your disobedience, but you'll be restored because of my promise. I said I'll be a Savior, and I will be. But that's the Old Testament, Pastor, and yes, you're right. But those promises did not have an expiration date, nor does it confine itself to the promises of Israel. Because he says the same of his church. They are my people. And when it says Jesus came to save the Jews and the Gentiles, there's a name that he used. I am the Savior of the world. I'm in the world. I'm in here. He's my Savior. He's your Savior. The life that you have is not easy. Sometimes your job's not easy. Your family's not easy. Your circumstances are not easy. Your health is not easy. Because we've all found out, life's not easy. But he's the Savior. For every need, for every issue. Because it's not about the need. As hard as that is to conceive, church, it's not about the need. It's about what's going on in your hearts. He's called your name. And he wants you to come near to him. Everything in your life is engineered for that express purpose, to bring you near to him. Now, I promise you, it doesn't always do that for everybody. For some come close, some go far away. But I believe I'm in the company of a people that believe I should come near to Jesus. So he is your Savior. So know this promise. As you go today, mark it in your Bibles if you have it with you. Put you a bookmark there. We still use those, don't we? I have to struggle finding some sometimes. They're still in existence. And I want you to make this personal. In all their affliction, he was afflicted. The angel of his presence saved them. In love and in pity, he redeemed them. And he bore them and carried them all the days of old. There's one word, if you can't remember all that, there's one word that sums all that up. And it's called providence. The providence of the Lord is upon you. He is watching for you. And he knows what you're going through. In all the stuff of your life, it's his stuff too. And I want you to know he's there for you, to carry you, to bear you up. And if he picks you up, well, he's got to let you down somewhere, don't he? And I'm not thinking about eternity here. Brother Jimmy, there's better days that are coming. There's called blessed ground, higher ground. There's breakthrough ground. There is when you prayed and you prayed and you call it, the breakthrough occurs. There's ground like that. I don't want there to be just a celebration at my death. I want one of those too. I pass from death to life. But I want some celebration ground between here and there. Because I got family in the other camp that needs to be liberated. I got people that I meet in the street that need to change their ways. I'm going to just tell you, I got neighbors that I watch their lives. Something needs to happen, and it's not an outpouring of the unholy spirit, but the Holy Spirit needs to get involved to clean up the mess that they're steeping their lives in. I am broken with the brokenness of people that I know their names. But he said in all their afflictions, he was afflicted. He will bear them up too. So I can't look with pride, but I can look with longing. God, for the day when they know what I know. Hey, for a day when all the church knows what I know. That our God's not dead, but he's still living and a victorious God for us. That's the message from Isaiah 63 that I leave with you today. But I ask you to bow your heads, and I'm going to ask the ushers to come. This is going to be a little different today. This is fifth Sunday, so for the first time since the pandemic. Is that right, Miss Peggy? She keeps up with this, and she has to remind me. We will have communion. And ushers, you can come. Because what we're going to do is we're going to have two go on either side. You can stay where you are. I wish we could all gather because I absolutely love that. I absolutely love us all packed together as a unity in the church, but we're not going to do that today. And it's not required to get the meaning of this message. So two will be in the middle, one will be on the end. Take and receive the elements. I'm going to bless them, and then they'll pass them out, but I'm going to talk to you while they're passing. Father, in Jesus' name. Dear God, there's nothing special, magical, or ornamental about what's right here. Dear God, it's bread and it's juice. God, it's just simple elements, but they testify to a spiritual truth, a historical truth, a truth that needs to be in every life. And that is that God is not distant. And God is certainly not absent. God is present.
Yes.
And God's presence needs to be at the center of all of our lives. Some take this to say that I will drink and eat my salvation. No. I'm symbolizing the salvation that I have received. It's in Jesus. It's in His blood shed for me. It is in His life that was given for me. That's my salvation. I claim it. It is mine. I receive you as Lord, and you are mine. Dear God, my status has changed to a child of God because of your actions. We celebrate that in this table. We call it a table because you made the food for us. You spiritualize it by saying, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you do not have life. And what you were saying was, unless you receive me as Savior and my life for your life, then you cannot be saved. But He has given. They can't even hide the cross in history. And though they try to say it's not really what you think it is, even our very times are divided by the cross. It stands there at just a stubborn message from the heavens that Jesus is the Savior of the world. Well, we don't fight that. We celebrate it individually. So for every heart that has prepared itself and says, God, you are mine, they may partake. Denominations are irrelevant. Dear Heavenly Father, status and home are irrelevant. All that matters is that Jesus is my Savior. So for everyone that does that, dear God, may they take this cup. And dear God, may they think of what you have done for them. Dear God, speak to us, I pray.
As you receive the elements today, Jesus called it, and Jesus showed it as broken bread and poured out wine. So I want you to meditate on that truth today. Broken relationships, broken dreams, broken plans, broken ideas, broken humanity. We're all broken. But He was broken to heal us. I remind you, I do pray over people that by His stripes you are healed. But if you read those contexts, He's speaking spiritually as well as physically. Our problems are not with our medical system. They do the best they can, and they are world class. But they can't heal all wounds. They can't fix all problems. They can't order what sin has disordered. Jesus says, I heal. And for every doubt that you may feel, can I just give you the testimony of history? From A.D. 33, to 2020, Jesus the Messiah has touched hearts and lives all over this world for over 2,000 years. Now you can deny it, but that's a whole lot of denial. And even around you, there are those whose lives are forever changed, forever healed by the power of Jesus Christ. Stand up, please. As Jesus shared His supper with the disciples, some of you have big family meals, and you can understand this a little better than us who don't.
you know how the dishes are all around the table and you got to pick them up and you got to pass them around? Everybody shouldn't grab from the middle of the table. That's rude. Mama probably smacked your hand for doing that. Don't do that. You got to share it. You got to pass it around. That's what Jesus did. He picked up the bread and he broke it. How would he do that? Just for sharing? Peter was at that table. You want to know how broken he was? Keep reading his story. Very broken. John was at that table. James was at that table. They're broken people that he was ministering to, even at the first Lord's Supper. So all these thousands of years, we still celebrate God healing broken people. God loving us and being our Savior. So he says, as often as you do this, as often as you eat this, you do it remembering me. Not the past me, the me with you right now. So please take it now. Because it's not kind and pleasant to go through a cross. Jesus said, if it takes a cross to say, Brian, Leon, Caleb, Peggy, take the cross. All his prayer was, whatever your will is, let it be done. That's the prayer. God said it takes a cross to save his church. Jesus said, I choose the cross. That's not pleasant. But then he took the cup. When he took the cup, he knew what the cup was going to be. He says, you got to drink all of it. All of it. You got to take some. We're not sharing cups. We're not doing that. But they would all drink of a new agreement with God. And it's a sweet agreement. It's a beautiful agreement. It's a stimulating agreement. Being right with God. No fear, no doubt, no worry. A destiny changed. Because the old covenant is gone. This is a new one. Well, it's not your sins that will stand before God, but it's Jesus who will stand before God for you. And you will be counted worthy. He said, drink this New Testament in my blood. Drink it in remembrance of me. Drink now. Jesus, we thank you for the promise fulfilled. I read of this testimony in four Gospels, but dear God, I live this Gospel this very day. Dear God, I was not born good, I have not lived good, but God, I have received Jesus Christ, and He has changed me, and He changes me still. God, Your work is in this church, and I rejoice in it. Your work is here for us. You are our Savior. So as we depart from this place and enter into a still broken, dysfunctional, imperfect world, let the light of the truth in us shine in a world full of lies. Expose the darkness for what it is. And dear God, let the light truly show salvation for all. Dear God, I saw this past week an interview with Katy Perry. Popular singer, more rich and known than I will ever be. Most all of us together will ever be. But the question was asked of her about her spiritual life. For she came from a Christian home, parents who were Christian still. She walked away from it all that she may pursue an acceptance and the riches and the pleasures of this world. But even her, in all of her affluence, and all of her notoriety, and in every whim of her, every thought met, she said, I still want goodness. I still want a reality of goodness. So whatever she has, and all that she has not satisfied the inner need of her heart. So God, let us be reminded of that. People embrace what they think will meet their needs, but we in this church have the answer No longing for what the world has, but a peace in what Jesus has done. May we live it, may we preach it, and dear God, may we comfort ourselves in it. You, our Savior, are with us, and you will carry us all the way. We bless your name today and thank you for this precious service. We pray these things in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.